So thank you all. Thanks for organizing this really great meeting. I'm thrilled to be in the audience as well because of who's speaking. And with that in mind, I sort of try to make a talk that maybe isn't the same talk I always give, but something that is sort of a little bit pointed more towards the future and tries to address some of the ideas and the issues that my lab is really struggling with, you know, as far as how tDCS works and obviously how to make it more effective. So that's, I'll be talking more about mechanisms, I think, than technology. And this is my conflict. Though I'm not going to be talking about any clinical data at all today. I'm really going to be talking just about cellular work. So let me sort of start with a little bit of a, I don't know if this is controversial or not, but sort of a oversimplified idea of how often at least clinical trials on tDCS are approached. And there's sort of these two pieces to the puzzle. I can just put it all up. One piece of the puzzle often is it seems that people approach brain function or dysfunction as a sliding scale, right? So there'll be a part of the brain maybe that is associated with depression, and it will be said that this region is just not active enough, right? That is the problem. Or there'll be a part of the brain associated with a type of learning, and the notion will be that if that part of the brain does more, we will do more of that learning, right? So this is very sliding scale, and this you know, has a long history of where it comes from. Often fMRI is just, you know, things light up and so on, right? And it has some limitations that are obvious. Now, on top of that, then people will often come in with transcranial direct current stimulation, which, as was introduced, it's a very appealing technology because it's so accessible. And it is also appealing because it's possible to simplify what it does based on this kind of concept, where a nodal turns up the volume of the brain region and cathodal turns down the volume of a brain region. So for example, if it's depression and a region is not active enough, we will apply a nodal to turn up the volume, right? And if you have epilepsy on a part of your brain, we will apply cathodal to turn down the volume. And so this is an idea that I wanted to discuss as far as how far this idea can take us, what are its limitations, and I'm obviously kind of hinting a little bit at the limitations here. And I'll really be talking about four papers that are cellular level papers, and the slides and the references I'll put online, so you know you'll have that information, and I know so will the whole talk. So just to take a step back and think about transcranial direct current stimulation in general, it's simplistically a battery connected to two sponges, but certainly it's not. But we can start with that. And the battery has a positive terminal, which is the anode, and a negative terminal, which is the cathode. And each one of those is connected to one sponge. And those sponges are put on the head. And so this would be an example of a sort of lateralized montage with an anode, the positive sponge, on the left side, and the cathode, the negative sponge, on the right side. And this is a computational model of my head. And as a result of putting the electricity across my head, it will flow across my head. And this was actually a montage that was developed and used at UPenn. And so I'm not going to be talking too much about models today, but these models tell us that this current will flow into the brain here and here. So it crosses like this and through my head. But more than simply where there is current, we can ask about the direction of the current. And so under the anode, current is emerging from the electrode. The positive current is emerging, and it's crossing in like this, and therefore crosses into the brain. As far as the brain is concerned, positive current is showing up. So it's inward to the brain. It's different on the cathode. Even though there's the same amount of total current here, the direction is opposite. The cathode is sucking up the positive current, and so from the perspective of the brain, the current is leaving. And so you have current that is inward under the anode and current that is outward under the cathode. And this idea ends up being very important to the concept I just explained before, where you have polarity-specific effects with tDCS, where the anode does one thing and the cathode does the other thing. And so you have this notion of, you know, the anode goes over the part you want to excite, maybe the cathode goes over the part you want to inhibit, And then on this other end, you have this sort of notion of more stuff at the anode, maybe less stuff at the cathode. And so what I'll be talking about today is this sort of question mark in the middle, right? Now you have to first assume this is true, which it may not be, right? And you have to assume that this is true, which it may not be. But let me at least start with the middle and explain our thought on the process. But it is useful to take a step back and at least in my opinion, and this may be debated and controversial, explain where maybe this idea might have come from. And so Michael Nietzsche already described the early work, and going back even to the 50s, right? The original LTP was done with animal work and applying DC current. And it's important to note that these were electrodes placed directly on the surface of the brain, so the intensities are much higher than anything that we're exposing to people. And as Michael mentioned, you have these outlasting effects. And so this is an example of what that kind of data would look like. Really great classical animal neurophysiology, cats, rats, and so you have a nodal and you have a firing rate, and then you put on a pretty large anodal current and you have more firing. And this can outlast. And cathodal, you have coming, and then this shuts down. So this is one key inspiration, right, for how we rationalize tDCS. Now, I'm not a cognitive neuroscientist. I'm sort of an engineer by background. But the question is, you know, is that example up there, does that mean that you're going to be reading better? Does this example mean that you will have, is this now you're less depressed? Because that part of your brain is not firing anymore, right? I mean, is this so? This notion of firing rate is very central to the sliding scale idea. One question is, how far can it take us? Another key finding, and we just heard from the founder of tDCS on this, is the use of TMS. So using TMS to probe the brain system and looking at how the response to TMS changes, and people often use this to rationalize that, but I think there is a very big difference between how Michael Nietzsche presents his work and how other people have taken his work, I would say, to justify things. Or maybe there's a bit of a gap there with what he says and what other people say he says, or what would like him to say. But that's I used to cite it. There's obviously been, we have a paper coming out every day, right? There's probably just a paper that was published while we were sitting in here on tDCS that used this to rationalize the study. But I would say that, you know, may not in itself prove the hypothesis. They're simply using that to justify the case. And as we've heard, there's been a lot of imaging study and so on. And again, I would venture that though often the imaging studies were designed with the a priori hypothesis that this was the case, and they really looked to prove this, they more often than not struggle to. And so this is where sort of the background of this comes in. So I'm going to be talking about work we've done at the brain slice level. So not obviously the clinical level, not even at the whole animal level, but really talking about dish and a tissue, and specifically brain slices, and specifically rat brain slices. And I'm not going to be going too much into the technique, so I'm happy to answer questions about it. This is obviously very, very divorced from this, right? Slices don't have behavior, and they are in many ways a very pathological system. They are dying even as you're studying them. What I hope to convince you through examples is that we obviously believe that there is something we can learn from working with this. So. Let me rehash this theory of neuronal polarization that Michael Nietzsche already illustrated, which is this notion of what's happening under the anode and the cathode. So this is the head surface, and that's the electrode. This is the cortical surface, and this is like a layer 5-6 pyramidal neuron, and they tend to have this sort of tail, this apical dendrite pointing up. So if this electrode is the anode, positive current will emerge from it and flow down along the screen. It's going to flow downward in this direction. And the theory is that this will cause a depolarization of the soma and a hyperpolarization of the dendrite. And because the soma is important, right, and the dendrite is not, this will lead to this increase in excitability and plasticity. So under the anode, we have soma depolarizing. The opposite is under the cathode. The cathode, the current is being sucked out of the brain, let's say. So it's flowing in this direction. So the polarization profile also flips. So now the soma is hyperpolarized and the dendrite is depolarized. And the if you say it's all about the soma, then you would say, well, this is a inhibited brain now. This is a brain that is less capable of plasticity and so on. And so that's this basic idea. And so I'm going to be talking about this notion of does this happen and does this help us bridge these two things? So this notion of cellular polarization as trying to link application, putting the batteries on someone's head and having them learn to shoot faster or something like that. But I wanted to, before moving in this direction, I just really wanted to address this first question. Does this actually happen? Do these cells actually polarize in this way and so on? And so this was work that now goes back about a decade that was done in the UK. We looked at this for a variety of different techniques, again using brain slices which lend themselves to it, as well as computational models. And the long story short is, as others had shown before us, this bimodal polarization is robust, at least under these conditions. So current is now flowing downward in this direction. So this might be considered a cathodal because the cell is pointed this way. And you can see here, for example, the optical imaging with voltage-sensitive dyes. This is actually mapping the cellular transmembrane potential. Using light, you can see this inverted polarization profile, obviously with some subtlety. And the same thing when we've done these multi-compartment neuronal models. And so you can see that the soma, if the soma was in the middle, it wouldn't be polarized at all. But because the soma is not in the middle, in this case it's on the cathode side, you get a small hyperpolarization. And in fact, you get even more polarization at the dendrites. And so one basic take-home message is that when you apply direct current to the brain, any brain, a rat brain slice or human brain, you produce membrane polarization, the cells polarize, but it's always bimodal. And so I was never fully comfortable with the notion of saying a depolarizing field or a hyperpolarizing field, but I think it is quite correct to say that a nodal stimulation to the cortex would produce dominantly somatic depolarization, even as the dendrite is being hyperpolarized, while cathodal would do the opposite. Cathodal would...
Can I ask a clarifying question?
Sure.
So is the distance between your anode and cathode comparable? Does that distance matter for where you have the transition from hyperpolarization to...
Oh, that's a good question.
Or,
so,
is what you're doing in a dish comparable to what's happening in a human brain?
We hope so.
In terms of the scale?
We hope so. So... So if this is sort of a cell sitting here, and this is in a dish, and I put an anode here and a cathode here, the current will flow downward. And this cell in this dish will be exposed to a certain intensity. We can change the amount of current we're putting across these wires to control the intensity that cell is exposed to. Now move over here to where we model current flow through the brain, and here's the anode and the skull and all that. The current flow is much more complicated. However, it is passing through the cell at one point, and we predict that we know how much that is. And I'll talk about that. It's less than a volt per meter. So in the dish, we expose it to the same thing. And so the physical distance of the anode and cathode may not matter so much. If this anode is much farther away, but this cell is exposed to the same juice, it's going to respond the same way. That's a good question. Right. So everything I've shown you up to now has the neuron lined up so conveniently. Thank you very much. Right in line. And that is a notion that underpins a lot of this somatic story. And if I have time at the end, it turns out it's all not true. I didn't want to get too much into it. That's another project that the cortex does not look like this. It did in the early animal studies, right? A lot of this cortex was very flat. That was very convenient. Our cortex looks more like this. And in fact, it can literally flip direction sometimes. And so this is a first order approximation to start the thought process. It's also a good question. So we took this a step further and we were able to actually expose brain slices to electric fields. And we were able to morphologically reconstruct them, record intracellularly from their somas, identify them biophysically as well, so there's different classes of cells. And in this case, we were asking the question, how much will the soma polarize? So not just qualitatively, one seesaw one way this way, but how much? And what we found was that it varied from cell to cell, with the most sensitive cells polarizing, the soma polarizes about 0.3 millivolts per 1 millivolt of electric field. So this is sort of the juice, the intensity that they're being exposed to. So if it was 2 volts per meter, it would polarize 0.6 volts, and if it was 10 volts per meter, it would polarize 3 millivolts, still not very much. This is the most sensitive cell out of the entire set that we were able to characterize. Many cells were a lot less. The simple explanation for this relates to the notion that, you know, if the soma is sort of in the middle of this structure, it's not that the cell doesn't polarize at all, it's just that the soma happens to be in a non-polarizing zone. And so these cells are the most asymmetrical. The soma is the most nearest the end, and so it polarizes relatively the most, but still not very much. So 0.3 millivolts doesn't sound like very much when an action potential is 100 millivolts, and cells might be tens of millivolts away from firing. And so if we look now back at the intensity of electric field here, it's around 0.4 volts per meter at 2 milliamps. So that's the peak. That's the most you're going to get, according to the models, with tDCS. So if we say we have 0.4 volts per meter, and the most sensitive cell is going to polarize 0.3 millivolts per volt per meter, we say that the most sensitive cell, under the most best case conditions, in the most sensitive part of the brain, the soma is going to polarize 0.12 millivolt. That's not a lot. That is not a lot. And so someone would say, oh, and then therefore tDCS can't possibly do any, right? But it's not the case, right? But it's certainly not a lot to work with. And it's almost below the level of noise, right? How much noise these cells are seeing. And so really what we got out of this study was that we don't get a lot of polarization. 0.12 millivolt is expected under tDCS. This is certainly not enough to make a cell fire. In comparison, transcranial magnetic stimulation, or ECT, will produce 100 volts per meter. So almost 1,000 times more than tDCS. That is enough to make a cell fire, because that will polarize the cell 1,000 times more. Right? That'll polarize a cell 12 millivolts or 50 millivolts. That's enough. So this is not, but as Michael Nietzsche was saying, therefore we're in the regime of subthreshold. We're in the regime of neuromodulation. We're in the regime of fields that do not trigger firing. They just polarize, and then something happens, right? And so we have a situation now where we have a current is reaching the brain, but it's producing a very weak electric field, and the cells therefore are not polarizing very much. And so we have this cell that has this bimodal polarization that's much less than a millivolt. And now I want to ask the question, well, why does that change excitability? Why would such a tiny polarization in the presence of a lot of background noise and a lot of activity, you know, why would that make you learn to ride a bicycle faster or slower, for that matter, right? How do we make that connection? And so to do that, I wanted to sort of touch back on what really is sort of the gold standard data of what tDCS does at all, which is that it changes the response to TMS. I mean, I think if we know one thing for sure about tDCS, we know that tDCS changes the responsiveness of the brain to TMS. And so what does that really mean? It means so nodal changing the sensitivity to an evoked response. And this is something that we can mimic and control very precisely in a piece of tissue where we have a cell now sitting in the dish, and that cell may be exposed to an electric field, and we have a synaptic pathway, an afferent pathway coming onto that cell. And we can tickle this pathway, make this axon fire, it'll send activity down, and I had a long flight, so I made this cartoon, right? That happens, right? And that glowing, this is not the cell firing. This is a postsynaptic current. This is an excitatory postsynaptic potential, glutamate being released, getting onto the next cell and triggering current there. So this is not firing. It's a EPSP, or the way we're looking at it, we're looking at it from the outside, so it's called a field EPSP, but it's certainly a quantitative metric of synaptic efficacy that's used all over the place, like in the core LTP studies and so on. So we can quantify that, and now we can do this in the absence of a field, in the presence of a field, without a field, in a dish. And we have a lot of resolution and thousands of repetitions, so we can really, really do this often, which is an advantage of working in a dish. But the effect is, in this case, was pretty clear. So under control conditions, this is the stimulus artifact, our equivalent of a TMS pulse that's sending this blast down. And then it takes a little while, and here's this postsynaptic current. Now, under a nodal stimulation, this dip got bigger. That meant that there was more current flowing into the cell. The EPSP got stronger. The cell did not fire. There's no action potential here. There's no action potential. Simply the cell received more current. More current was flowing into it. It got a bigger response. So for the same volley, bigger EPSP. And the opposite thing happened when we did cathodal stimulation. So when we applied cathodal stimulation, the opposite of that picture, the EPSP got smaller. And the higher intensity we applied, the bigger the response was. And I'm also giving you a bird's eye view of a lot of the data is in these papers. Now, maybe you can argue this was obvious. Well, all the inputs don't necessarily come in right on the soma. That's a nice cartoon way. It turns out the inputs are coming all over. And in fact, most of the inputs come onto the dendrite, right? That's sort of the tentacle that's accepting all these inputs. But the dendrite is polarized opposite to the soma. So for me, it was not trivial to say, well, what happens to these layer 2-3 cells? These are more of these cortical inputs that are coming in. And I don't know enough about TMS to say necessarily which one of these are activated by TMS. I'd guess a mix. But we can probe this as well. And it turns out that we saw the same behavior. So even if the input comes in to the apical dendrite, a nodal soma depolarizing makes it bigger, which means that the somatic depolarization determined the change. And we tried a whole bunch of different pathways, because we can do that in a slice, coming in from different directions and so on. And always, at least in rat slice motor cortex, soma polarization determined the effect of the change. And so we can say that a nodal stimulation is increasing synaptic efficacy. For the same volley of input coming in, this neuron will respond more. It's capable of responding more. And the other way around, if we hyperpolarize the cell, for the same volley coming in from wherever, this neuron will actually respond less. This is not, yeah.
So just to clarify here, because this is not the way it's oftentimes portrayed. So it's not just that you're adding an offset to the postsynaptic potential. You're actually amplifying the postsynaptic. It's like you're changing the gain on the synapses as opposed to just bringing the cell closer to its threshold.
And I think it's a nice way to talk about it. It's a gain issue. There's a lot of people who study synapses think a lot about gain control. I think it's talked about in other systems. There's a lot of gain control going on in these synapses, and the gain of the synapse has now been increased. Right, so the same inputs, bigger output, yeah. And I wanted to show you the same experiment but in a different way, because I think this kind of makes it a little bit more relatable to people, let's say, combining tDCS with behavior or rehabilitation. And so now the experiment, it's similar, but now we're applying a train of pulses, like boom, 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 boom. And that's all the little artifacts you see there, right? And so we're getting EPSP, 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 EPSP. Turns out because of gain control, these are a lot smaller than they would be on their own, by the way, right? They normally would be about this big, but the system can't, with so much input coming in, gain is actually decreased, and the system can respond less to each one. Now we apply what I'm calling a nodal DCS, so soma depolarizing, and these EPSPs get bigger. So this volley is coming in, and this neuron is now able to respond more, let's say, right? I'm trying to sort of anthropomorphize this neuron's behavior, but it's able to respond more, right? The same inputs are coming in. Let's say you're learning something, but now this neuron is able to respond more to that input. Same input, it's able to sustain a higher level of activity, and this in turn may relate to the ability to produce plasticity. And so I mean, you can see it here, but again, being an, this being a slice, we can look at it 100 different ways and rotate the slice and look at multiple different pathways, but it's a pretty robust finding. It's, I'll talk about the sensitivity of it in a second, as in how big this change is. But there's this notion that under a nodal stimulation, you can sustain a higher level of synaptic input. You're able to process more information. Your gain has gone up. And this is independent necessarily of how much you're firing. And so I've changed these two bits here to say something a little bit different. You've depolarized the soma, but I'm not saying you're going to fire more. I'm just going to say that your synaptic processing has somehow been enhanced. Your ability to accept and process input under the situation is somehow boosted, which is a little different than saying firing. And so that's really the take-home message of this paper, which has much more physiology built into it. But it piggybacks onto these other points. So the final study I wanted to talk about. Now, in slice, you're also able to induce something that looks like oscillations in people. And by look like, I just mean it has the same frequency. Right, and so you're able to bathe these slices in carbachol and other drugs, and these slices will spontaneously start to oscillate at certain frequencies, in this case in the gamma band, and that's what you're seeing in the voltage. Just that slice on its own, I'm not stimulating it, it's just oscillating because it's in the bath. We've also, in the same study, developed network models that are able to mimic this behavior as well. And so in this particular paper, we're doing side-by-side brain slice physiology and network modeling, and I'll explain why. Now, this system is very different than what I've showed you before. This is no longer a neuron just sitting around waiting for something to happen. This is an active system. You have a whole network of excitatory neurons. You have a whole network of inhibitory neurons. And they're always active. They're constantly active. They're humming away. And it's that humming that's generating this oscillation. So the question is, what happens in this situation when you apply a field? And we've shown, and others showed before us, that these systems are highly responsive to DC polarization. These cells are not at minus 80 anymore. They're not at minus 70, right? They're actually just below firing threshold. They're there all the time. The system is maintaining these cells at the cusp of firing so that a tiny oscillation, right, can sort of increase their coherence and so on. But these cells are completely, the system is in fact designed to bring the system up. It's not quite epilepsy, but it's certainly not quiet. And so you have a system that's already really, really responsive. So now you apply a nodal depolarizing field, and you see this huge change in power, right? You get a big change in power. Now, I'll talk about it in a second. It doesn't last, right? But you also see this inhibition. It does somewhat last during the course of stimulation. And for short stimulation, it reverses. Turns out that for long stimulation, it doesn't quite come back, right? But I want to focus on the short story here. So what this told us was that going back to this, and you see I'm still reverting back to the sliding scale idea, right? We could say that as far as oscillation power goes, and there's people looking at this now clinically as well, and nodal seems to give you more power. Somehow soma depolarization boosts the oscillation power of the system, and cathodal gives you less power. Now, does that mean, right, that you're now going to learn something faster? I mean, how do we relate it to that? And what's nice about having this very reduced system is, you know, we can dig in, right? We don't have to look at it sort of just phenomenologically. We can actually look in at the cellular and the subcellular level to ask what was going on. And we were particularly interested in these transients. So here you can see that the system started to respond very robustly. And then it seemed to kind of decrease. Now, it's still boosted relative to what's going on here, right? But it's actually it's not as ants as it used to be. It's almost like the system responded somehow, that the system was exposed to a field, it started to go out of control, and then some sort of excitatory, inhibitory feedback loop became aware of it and corrected the state. And this is, an average trace. Some slices responded more. Some slices didn't respond very much at all after this transient. They returned back to baseline. And then after, in this case, you can see, again, there's a sort of inhibition. And then you can sort of see there's a bit of a recovery from it, almost like the system returns up its own volume, its own gain. And we know it's there because here when we turn off the field, you get this sort of rebound. So you can imagine that in this case, the system was inhibited. And so what it did is it tried to change its state. right? It said, you know what, I wanna try to make myself somehow more active, right, using this loop. But as soon as the field came off, you get this overshoot. And so we were able to look at this in quite a bit of detail, and certainly I'm giving you the bird's eye view, but it's in that reference. And what we were able to find was that the oscillation power was only half of the story, and not even the most interesting part of the story. It turned out that when you applied anodal stimulation and the power went up, both the excitatory and the inhibitory neurons and synapses were much more active. So it wasn't just like you got more excitatory firing, you did, but now the inhibitory system kicked in as well. So whereas before, let's say you had this much excitation and this much inhibition going on, under nodal stimulation, you had much more of both. Which is a little bit different than just saying more excitability, more function. So even if there was no power change, right, even if the system was now able, so you had a certain balance of excitation and inhibition, now you apply nodal, even under no power change, you may have a new balance of a nodal and inhibition, a much higher level. And that's what we're able to show, because again, using these systems, we're able to analyze this in a lot of detail. So the synaptic state of the system was highly altered. And so in this study, what we're able to conclude is, one, this sort of feedback, this state of the system was what explained its high sensitivity. The system was so high strung to begin with by design that a small perturbation, right, could produce a very strong response. But what was also, for me, more interesting was power aside, once the field was present, the system went into a new state, right? A new state where the system was not as it was before, let's put it that way, right? The fundamental dynamics of the system had been altered. So it's not the same system it was before. And so I would assume that it would not process incoming information in the same way, right? So thinking about the dynamics of the system rather than sort of just one metric of power. And so that's what's shown here, this notion that when you, and this still followed the sort of somatic polarity convention, where fields that depolarize the soma would tend to increase power and would tend to generally increase the synaptic tone of the system, for lack of a better word, and vice versa. And so that was this fourth point that I wanted to talk about. And so you see that nowhere here am I talking about necessarily just more firing. That's not, in fact, in this case here, you don't necessarily have to have a higher firing rate of the pyramidal neurons to have a bigger oscillation, right? This is a current-driven system, right? And so I guess if there are sort of four take-home messages from each of these physiology studies, this is sort of what they would be. And now I just want to, I don't know how much time am I in time? Okay. So now let me try to walk that back to this whole sliding scale idea that I started with earlier. And I don't have a resolution to that, but just some thoughts. I did want to mention in the same paper, though, there's a lot of interest now in tACS, and I'm not talking about that today, but in a slice and in this computational model, you're able to really apply, you know, every possible frequency, every possible amplitude, or you're able to really characterize the dynamics of the system and how it responds. So not just asking, do you get less or more power, right? But how is that power altered? So for example, with low intensity AC stimulation, you may provide such low intensity that you don't change the power, but you entrain it. You change the phase, so now it becomes phase locked. If you apply very low frequency, what you may actually do is you modulate it. So when, you know, you make it less, more, right? Like an amplitude modulated signal. And there's a whole range of behaviors that you can produce, subharmonics and so on. And I know, as with the DC sliding scale, people will often say, okay, I have an oscillation, so I'll put in AC and I will get more oscillation. But that's really the exception to the rule from what we've seen. All right, so going back to this idea that maybe this is wrong, but it's certainly been my perception that at least some studies on tDCS adopt this sort of rationale. You know, paragraph number one, right, is, or paragraph number one would be something about some brain region implicated in some function, And paragraph number two would be citing the animal studies and Michael Nietzsche's work to explain that tDCS can therefore change the function of that brain region, right, by putting a pad over it. Is there another way to think about it? I'm not sure. You know, this is what we're thinking about now. Can you think about how tDCS actually modulates how a region processes information in both an acute and a plastic way? There's certainly been recent work looking at learning and firing rate, showing, for example, that you can learn something, and it doesn't mean that that part of your brain now fires more. It just means that when you are maybe re-exposed to that same experience, you are more responsive to it, right? In that situation, you will fire more. But it doesn't mean your brain is somehow humming at a higher level all the time. So it's a little bit subtle, and so we can try to think about if there's a slightly more refined way to approach this issue. There is something else that the last thing I'll touch on that sort of troubles me a lot about this idea is that we're still thinking about each brain region as sort of doing one thing, right? And it seems like that's really nonspecific. To try and the question is why, if you are a lab that studies motor performance, does tDCS help with motor performance? But if you're a lab that studies cognition, something else, it helps with that. And if you're a lab that studies depression, then tDCS then happens to help you with depression, right? Where does the specificity of tDCS come from? It's not really something I've talked about until now, but certainly one area where we think specificity can come from has to do with where you deliver the current, right? So if you stimulate the whole brain, you may produce less specificity. If you are able to deliver the current to a more targeted region, now you have more specificity. And so we've been working on modeling and technology that will help you do that. And the 4X1 montage is one example where as you make that ring smaller and smaller, you can focus down to an individual region more and more. The problem with this is it still leaves you with a situation where you're kind of treating this one region like a dial. It doesn't seem to give you much. It's almost, if that brain region only did one thing, this might be all right. You know what I mean? If that brain region, it might be all right, but it still leaves something unsatisfying. And so I just want to point with really a cartoon, not data, where some of the work we're doing now is directed at. And that's thinking that if you had an electrode and you are now stimulating even a smaller brain region, so let's say you could focus it to a brain region of interest, or even let's say you don't care about stimulating the whole brain, but you just care about one region of interest. But inside that brain region, you may have a network of cells that you are interested in, the reading, cells, and then you have another network of cells that you are less interested in, the comprehension cells. And as we know, tDCS is rarely applied on its own in behavioral interventions. It's always combined with something, right? So if you want people to get better at reading, I keep coming back to reading, but if you want to give it a reading, they read, right, as you stimulate them. If you want them to get better at moving their hand, after a stroke, then you apply tDCS during rehabilitation of that hand, not the other hand. And you certainly don't expect to see benefit. You don't expect to see benefit. So this notion of integration that goes beyond spatial, but seems to go into a functional level. And so the question, and so this seems very to me very important to the notion of specificity. And so even though current is affecting all these cells in this whole region, for some reason the effects are only happening at the regions that are functionally coactivated. Turns out in a brain slice, you can do this very precisely, right? We can activate one pathway while leaving the other one inert, right? And see, for example, if now when we apply DC field, the plasticity is only produced at the co-activated pathway. So that would provide very direct evidence, right, that if you have, let's say, a system of ongoing learning, right, and that could just be these very specific set of axons, and there may be many other ones, and now you apply a DC field, you boost the learning only in those axons and not in the other ones. And so that's, for me, a very appealing idea, because now we have infinite specificity, right? You really are training to the task, and I'd be excited to come back with you with data showing that. Up to now, I really didn't quite show you anything that would support that idea. And so that's where I'll stop, and thank you.